ما بعد، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. جزء 10 part 1 فهم القرآن. إن شاء الله we'll see the summary. In this we'll cover سورة الأنفال and we'll start سورة التوبة 2 إن شاء الله. In part 1 we'll start سورة الأنفال from آية number 41. And know that anything you obtain of war booty, then indeed for Allah is one-fifth of it, for the messenger and for his near relatives, and the orphans, the needy, and the stranded traveler. Excuse me. If you have believed in Allah and that which we send down to our servant on the day of criterion, the day when the two armies met, and Allah over all things is competent. وَعَلَمُوا أَنَّمَا غَنِمْتُمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ خُمُسَهُ. So previously the question was asked by the Sahaba and the answer is given here. At the beginning of Suratul Anfal, we learned that Sahaba had some dispute over who the booty should be go to. And here, يَسَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْأَنْفَال, they ask you about the war booty. But now here that you should, now the answer has been given. Allah and His Messenger Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what you need to worry about is your mutual relationship, is how you are behaving with one another and your akhlaq and amal, because the objective behind the battle was not to obtain booty, okay? The objective was to attain the pleasure of Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala. So what is the point of that money which you get your hands, you know? However, you have acquired with the wrath of Allah because of what you have done. So now after all these verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains who the booty should go, how it should be divided. Remember that ghanim, like you know, war booty is the wealth that is obtained by fighting the enemy in a battle, okay? Amongst the Arabs. But amongst the Arabs, the tradition was whoever finds whatever in the battle, they get to keep it. You know, keepers, finders or keepers. However, in Islam, some regulation were put in place. And if you think about it, when an army is defeated, when an army is overcome, what is the objective? That the enemy must be disarmed, isn't that? So, because if the enemy is left to go with their weapons, what they are going to do? They are going to come and fight you again. So, if Muslims have gotten victory over their enemy, what is the natural consequence of that victory? That enemy is going to be disarmed. Okay? But if the enemy has managed to escape, then what we have to do? Then of course they were running, they left behind something in the battlefield. So other is left behind, and also those have been killed off their belongings also in the what is lying in the battlefield. Now, instead of letting all of these things go waste or destroying them, a legal system has been put. So, in legal system, place to determine what must be done and with this acquisition, with this property. So, firstly, we learn that is that everything that is found in the battlefield is to be deposited. Okay, deposited where? With the public treasury or with the leader. No one can take anything from it, what they please. If they do it, this is considered a serious theft, okay? Causing a person to go to the hellfire. So no one can say, oh, I found it there, so I am keeping it. No, they can't do it. They have to deposit it. And that is why we see that when it comes to inheritance also, we cannot do with our property what we will. Even when a person is dying, he cannot waste that money. He cannot do with the whatever he pleases. So it has to be divided according to the inheritance given in the Islamic way. So here the Messenger of Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, for his near relatives, the orphans, the needy, the stranded traveler, the fifth part of the booty is going to be further divided into five portions. Why? Because this must be given to who? This wealth must be distributed in the society in all fairness. Because whenever there are group of people living somewhere, like you know, then remember the wealth must be shared to some extent. Because it is those with the strength, with some ability, with some power who keep going forward and who keep making more and more money. And those who are weak, who are suffering from poverty, and what happened? They keep getting left behind. So we see over here that Allah has allotted to share to all people. All people means, and from what we have learned is that the wealth that Allah has given us is not just for us. The wealth we do get our hands on it is not just for us. We must also think about other people whom we are living among, the other people who are in the society. We must give a portion of our wealth to them also. And we see over here that the correct division is what? It is made a part of the iman. Because we see in kuntum amantum billahi. If you are truly believe in Allah, truly believe in Allah, then you must distribute this booty according to law of Allah. Meaning you must abide by the law that Allah has given you. So what do we see here? If a person believes in Allah, then he must change his action, he must change his habits. Even because it's possible that there is something we have been doing all our lives, then we learn that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects something else, we are doing wrong, then we have to amend our things. So here, in kuntum amantum billahi, if you truly believe in Allah, then you must abide by this law. Then we have to change our habits also, okay? We should amend our things. And then Allah says that, let's move to other ayah. Remember when you were on near side of the valley and they were on the farther side of the caravan, was lower in the position than you. In ayah number 42. The believers are being reminded of the battle of Badr. That remember this victory that happened. It didn't just happen because of your own effort. First of all, the battle that occurred didn't just occur because you wanted. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought it because, recall when you were on the near side of the valley and they, means the meaning the army of 1000, they were on the farther side and the caravan was lower in the position than you. Because we see that Abu Sufyan, he was taking the caravan safely from the different route to Makkah. If you had made appointment to meet, you have missed the appointment. If you had decided from before with the enemy that such and such day, at such place you would fight them in battle. What does Allah says here? You know, either you would not shown up or they would not have shown up. You know, because many time it happens that when we find something difficult, even though we were going to do it, we don't do it, you know. So here we see that war is something that is very difficult, and this was the first battle. So Allah says, if you have decided from before, if the day was appointed, you would never be ended up fighting one another. So what do we see? That the circumstances were created such that Muslims were pushed in the battle, even though they were unprepared mentally, physically, they were not prepared. But they were pushed to. Why? Because when we have to do something first time, we are hesitant, isn't it? So we have to do something that new we have done before. It's easy to do. So that's how they did it, alhamdulillah, and Allah gave the success. But it was so that Allah might accomplish a matter that was already destined. So what do we see? What is in the destiny can never be avoided. And that those who perish through disbelief would perish upon evidence, and those who lived in faith would lived upon evidence. Meaning Allah wanted this war to come about, this battle to occur, this confrontation to occur. Why? So that the truth made clear and falsehood also made clear. Because Muslims were being opposed since very long time. They were considered weak, and generally what happens when someone is seen poor and weak, oppressed, people generally think that, oh, they are wrong, they are false, they are in the wrong. But with the victory, what happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and those who with him are upon haq, and those who oppose them, they are upon falsehood. And indeed, Allah is hearing and knowing. What do we see in this ayah? Sometimes in life, you know, certain situation they come about, and this situation seems very very heavy and very difficult on us. And suddenly these things come about, we consider them to be serious problems. But what happens? We see that also like khair, in also goodness, Allah put us in unavoidable circumstances so that we do things we would never do. So that's how here happens, you know. So here, Battle of Badr, the Muslims were made to encounter the enemy for which they were not otherwise ready. They were not ready financially, they were not ready mentally, physically. But here they were pushed to, and here they were with their own blood relatives, they were own friends. Now they are fighting with them, they are having the battle. And they were doing for the sake of Allah, Raditu Billahi Rabbom. I am pleased with Allah as my Lord. Ayah number 43, remember, O Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, then Allah showed them to you in your dream as few, if he had shown them to you as many. Meaning, if you had come to know their actual numbers, if you know about the reality, then you believers would have lost courage and would have disputed in the matter. Which matter? Whether to go or fight or not. You would never be ready, in the other words. Means this was shown in the dream. Allah saved you from that. Indeed, he is knowing of that which is within your chest. Now, the difficulty sometimes is far greater than we are made to perceive sometimes. It happens, we are put in difficult situation. We think, yes, it's difficult and we handle it. We manage it. But then, what happens later on, we realize that, oh, that problem was actually much bigger, right? The problem was actually much bigger, but we didn't know the scope of the problem. We didn't know the reality of its situation. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala conceal it from us? For our own good. Because if we know how great it was, we would never go for it. Isn't so? Like, for example, marriage, does it have, after marriage, so many problems. Like, if we tell before, nobody will able to do it. So here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that was a hikmah behind it. And later on, how they were successful. Walakin Allah, indeed, he is knowing of what that which is within the chest. Alimum bizzatis sudur. And remember, when he showed them to you, when you met a few in your eyes, and he made you appear as few in their eyes, so that Allah might accomplish a matter already destined. And to Allah are all matters returned. Ya ayyuhallazina amanu, O you have believed, when you encounter a company from enemy's force, then what you should do? Then be firm. Fasbutu. Waskurullaha kaseera, and remember Allah much. Why? La'allakum tuflihun, so that you may be successful. What else should you do? Watiullaha wa rasuluhu. Obey Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is that you should refrain from? Wala tanazaw. Do not dispute with one another. Why? Because if you do, then thus lose courage and then your strength would depart. What else we should do? Wasbiru, and be patient. Inna Allaha ma'as-sabirin. Indeed, Allah is with those who are patient, because without sabr, nothing can be accomplished. And when you do sabr, then what will happen? You will get Allah's help. So we have to do sabr. Waskurullaha kaseera. Remember Allah much. First be firm and yourself zikr of Allah, and Allah will give you the success. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever is frightened by the darkness of the night, we feel, do you afraid by the darkness of night? We get afraid. Maybe you feel afraid in the night time when you wake up for suhoor, when you're praying or so on. So this is, whoever is afraid by the darkness of the night, whoever is afraid of spending wealth is whose way? In Allah's way. Or the weakness of facing the enemy, meaning he feels weak for face enemy, he afraid of facing the enemy, then he should increase in saying Subhanallahi wa bihamdi. If we have all this, we should say Subhanallahi bihamdi. What is then person should say to overcome his fear, or to rest his heart, to calm his fear? Subhanallahi wa bihamdi. For these words are more beloved to Allah than a mountain of gold being spent in the way of Allah. So whenever we are stressed out, afraid in night, or facing challenges, so just say Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi. And Subhanallahi wa bihamdihi wa subhan. And this is a hadith from Sahih at-Targhib wa Tartib. Then there is one more hadith here. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, beware of evil with each other. Meaning, consider concern about your mutual relationship, for indeed it is the haqq. Like, you know, one that completely mows down, one that completely shaves off, meaning it is something that these enemies, what they do, they completely destroy the good deeds of a person. If you think it is in our personal lives also, if we entertain hate for another person in our heart, what is going to do? It's going to affect our prayers and it's going to affect our mood. So we should avoid that thing. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, beware of the evil which each other, for indeed it is the haqa. It will not let you continue, it will let you grow, because you see the work of deen is like a plant, is like a tree that needs to be grown. But when these enemies come in, what happens? Then the lawnmower is passed on. When it passed on, beautiful flowers, the lovely grass, it's completely destroyed. That is what our garden will produce. So we have to be careful what we are doing. وَلَا تَكُونَ كَالَّذِينَ خَرَجُوا مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ بَطَرًا. And do not be like those who came forth from their home insolently, arrogantly, and to be seen by the people. Avoid them from the way of Allah, and Allah is encompassing of whatever they do. Means watakunu, you should be like them, because there is huge difference between the apparent of Muslims and the appearance of the kafir. So maintain the difference, do not imitate them, do not be like the kafir. And remember when shaitan made their deeds pleasing to them and said, no one can overcome you today from among the people, and indeed I am your protector. We learn that shaitan literally came in human form to assist the non-Muslims in the battle. Literally, in human form he came. But what happened? But when two armies sighted each other, shaitan turned to his heels and said, indeed I am disassociated from you. Indeed I see what you do not see. What is that he saw? Angels. Indeed, I fear Allah, and Allah is severe in penalty. So here, amazing, he fears Allah, yet he does not stop his wrong. Do you see that? So those people also who say that they fear Allah and they know that what is wrong, they do not stop it, then who are they imitating? Whose way is it? Shaitan way. Now, what do we learn over here? Shaitan, even though he came physically to participate in the battle, what happened? When he saw the Muslim army, what happened then? When he saw the angel, he fled, he ran away. And this teaches that shaitan does not have any power over Allah's servant. He cannot overcome, he cannot defeat them, he cannot control them. But this is when we are united, when we are firm, when we are doing our best, when we are doing the zikr of Allah, then we are not busy fighting with each other, but we are busy working, doing what we have to do. Remember when the hypocrites and those in whose heart was disease said, their religion has deluded those Muslims. You know, in ayah number 49, hypocrites, they commented this time that the people have gone crazy. How are they 300 going to fight 1,000? How are they going to survive? These 300 will do, like, you know, it's, if you look at it was like, looks like very difficult, and Allah helped them anyway. And this 1,000 people that have come, their enemy, they have so much, like, how on earth they are going to face this challenge? These people have gone crazy and so on and so forth, they were saying. They are putting their life in danger. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help. وَمَا يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. But whoever relies upon Allah, then indeed Allah is exalted in might and wise. So Allah help them. And here let's move to ayah number 50. وَلَوْ تَرَى. And if you could but see when the angels take the soul of those who disbelieve. وَلَوْ تَرَى إِذَا يَتَوَفَّى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا. Because 70 of them were killed in the battle of Badr. The angels, when they took their souls, how they take them? They are striking their faces and their backs and saying, taste the punishment of burning fire. So what do we see here? That before punishment of fire is the punishment of Hashr. Before which is the punishment of grave. Before which the punishment of the time of death. Because the torture that is being described, there is that which will happen at the time of death. beating and striking. In ayah number 51, that is for what your hands have put forth of evil, and because Allah is not ever unjust to His servants. وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ لَيْسَ بِالظَّلَّامٍ لِلْعَبِيدِ Allah is not unfair to His servants if they end up in this result, but it is because they have brought it upon themselves. Theirs is like the custom of the people, like you know how the people of Firaun, mind of those before them, they disbelieve in the signs of Allah. So Allah sees them for their sins. Indeed, Allah is powerful and severe in penalty. Meaning the end of Makkah of Mushrikeen were very similar to the end of Firaun. And those who follow Pharaoh, how that they persist in their wrong ways until eventually they were drowned. And once they were drowned, they were admitted into fire. The punishment began from that moment onwards. Even the people of Nuh, what did we learn about them? They were drowned. And they were admitted to the fire. Udkhilun nar, meaning immediately punishment began. That is because Allah would not change a favor which He had bestowed upon a people until they change what is within themselves. And indeed Allah is hearing and knowing. We have to change ourselves within. Like you know, you have to amend your things. In Hadith, we learned that Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, before him, a man was eating with his left hand. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told him, eat with your right hand. You know, he was eating with left. He said, no, I cannot. He refused. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, may you never be able to do so. Meaning, may you never be able to eat with your right hand. And it happened that man was never able to lift his right hand up to his mouth after that day. Allah gave him the blessing of the right hand, even if it hurts a little bit. But when Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was telling him that eat with your right hand, what should we do? We should listen to, try to do that. But he avoided that because of this fault. So whenever we see the blessings has been taken away from us, all of a sudden, something that we enjoy, we have been taken away. What happened? What went wrong? We need to analyze ourselves. We need to ask Allah forgiveness. Astaghfirullahi atubu ilayh. There is like a custom of people of Pharaoh and those before, they denied the signs of the Lord. We destroyed them for their sins and we drowned them, people of Pharaoh, and all of them were wrongdoers. In ayah number 55, indeed the worst of living creatures in the sight of Allah are those who have disbelieved and they will not ever believe. Meaning the truth came before them, they still did not believe. The ones with whom you made a treaty, but they break their pledge every time and they do not fear Allah because they are breaking the treaty. If you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, gain dominion over them in war, disperse by means of them those behind them that perhaps they will be reminded. Meaning when there is a group of people who recognize the truth, yet they reject it, then you make a treaty of peace with them. But then they violate that, not just because once, but many times. What should you do? Do not be deceived by them. If these people cannot fight against you, then you also fight them back and teach them a lesson. Here, لَعَلَّكُمْ يَذَكَّرُونَ. And here in ayah number 58, if you have reason to fear from a people betrayal, throw their treaty back to them, putting you on equal terms. Indeed, Allah does not like traitors. Inna Allah la yuhibbul qa'ineen. Here, Inna Allah yuhibbul qa'ineen. Allah does not like the traitors, those who cheat. This is very important thing that we need to learn. Who is that Allah loves? Allah loves people who are honest and trustworthy. And people who betray, Allah does not like them. Hadith, the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, if you have four qualities in you, then whatever you lose in the world would not ever harm you. If you possess four qualities, then no matter what you suffer in this life, it would not harm you. It's not a loss because you have these four qualities. Because of these qualities, what will happen? Whatever loss you have incurred, Allah will give you something else better in the place of it. What are these qualities? Guarding trust, Hafaza amanat. Okay? Being truthful in one's speech. Wasadakul hadith. Talking truthful speech. And then being good in one's manner, in one's etiquette. And fourthly, husnul quluq. Third one. And consuming halal risk. You know, iffat tu'ama. Being careful with respect to the food of that a person is acquiring, the money that a person is making, and that is being able to leave what is unlawful, being able to abstain from what is in yours. Like, you know, first we learn from that guarding trust, amanat, and then being truthful, you know, saduha, being truthful, and husnul quluq, third one, and iffat tama, like consuming halal food. So if person has four qualities, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you don't need to fear any loss. There is one more hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, kufr and iman cannot be together in one heart. Truthfulness and lying cannot be together in one. Amanat and khiyanat cannot be together. There is one more, this hadith. And then, and let not those who disbelieve think that they will escape. Indeed, they will not cause any failure to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And prepare against them whatever you are able to, power of steadfast of the war, in which you may terrify the enemies of Allah and your enemy and other besides them who you do not know, but who Allah knows. And whatever you spend in the cause of Allah will be fully repaid to you, and you will not be wrong. If they incline to peace, meaning if the enemy is inclined to peace, what you should do? Insist on fighting just because you are ready for? No. Then incline it to also, meaning avoid war and avoid what they say, then you have to do it. And watawakkal Allah, and rely upon Allah. We all should rely upon Allah. Rely upon Allah, indeed it is who is hearing and knowing. But if they intend to deceive you, the sufficient for you is Allah. It is who supported you with his help and with the believers. Wa allafa baina qulubihim, and brought together their hearts. Whose hearts? Of the believers. Because remember, it's just not because to prepare with weapons, it is also necessary to prepare hearts. If people are not together, if they are not united, if they do not love each other, then what will happen? They cannot stand together. It's hard. Wa allafa baina qulubihim, Allah joined their hearts together. If, O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you had spent all that is in earth, you could not have brought their hearts together. But Allah brought them together. Indeed, He is exalted in might and wise. Subhanallah. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the believers loves and he love in return. And the person who does not love, who is not loved, then there is no good in him. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said one more hadith, you shall not enter paradise so long as you do not have iman, and you cannot have iman as long as you don't love each other. Should I not tell you how you should love each other? Say salam to one another. Why? Because how is salam the key to loving each other? Because salam is the key to communication, isn't it? When you greet somebody, what is usually the next question to the comment or something, like, you know, how are you, and then so on, we start talking it. When we ask the other person and they reply you back, so alhamdulillah, that's how the salam is, and we can join the hearts. Wa allafa baina qulubihim. Ya ayyuhan nabi, O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, hasbukallah, sufficient for you is Allah. And for us also, this is a dua, hasbunallah wa ni'mal wakeel. And hasbukallah, Allah is enough for us. So put trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for whoever follows you of the believers, meaning until the end of time, any believers who follow the messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is sufficient for him. Allah will aid him, Allah will guide him and support him. Any believers who follow Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and see that ittiba'i Rasul, it has so many benefits. So earlier we learned in Suratul Al Imran that, you know, you love Allah, then follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what will happen? Allah will love you. So hasbukallah, Allah is sufficient for him. O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, urge the believers to battle, meaning the battling is something that is not easy, it is difficult, it has challenges, everyone knows that. It is right thing to do is something difficult, people feel weak. So the role of the leader is to motivate those who are with him. So in our families also, what do we need to do? Motivate, encourage our family members to fast, to pray, to give charity, especially in the month of Ramadan, because everybody knows it's right thing to do, but the difficult of it. So we should encourage each other. Is there among you 20 who are steadfast? They will overcome 200. If there are among you 100 who are steadfast, they will overcome 1,000 of those who have disbelief, because they are people who do not understand. Now Allah is helping them, that's how. Now Allah has lightened the hardship for you, and He knows that among you is the weakness. So if there are from you 100 who are steadfast, they will overcome 200. If there are among you 1,000, they will overcome 2,000 by the permission of Allah, and Allah is with the steadfast. So here we learn hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Nasr, help, is with sabr. So the help of Allah comes where? With the patience, meaning you have to be patient first, so the help of Allah will come. If we are not patient, then why, like, the help of Allah will be difficult. So first thing we have to be doing the sabr, inshallah. There is one more hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever remains patient, then Allah will make him patient. Nobody can give a blessing greater than sabr. Subhanallah. It is not for a prophet to have captives of war until they inflict a massacre upon Allah's enemies in the land. Some Muslim desire the commodities of this world, but Allah desire for you the hereafter, and Allah is exalted in might and wise. If not for the decree from Allah that preceded you, you would have been touched for what you took by the great punishment. So consume what you have taken of war booty as being lawful and good, and fear Allah. Indeed, Allah is forgiving and merciful. So Allah is reminding again and again to be fearful. We are on Suratul Anfar, ayah number 70. O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, say to whether is in your hands of the captives. If Allah knows any good in your hearts, He will give you something better than what was taken from you. He will forgive you, and Allah is forgiving and merciful. But if they intend to betray you, then they have already betrayed Allah before, and He empowered you over them, and Allah is knowing and wise. Indeed, those who have believed and immigrated and fought with their wealth and lives in the cause of Allah, and those who gave shelter and aided, they are allies of one another. But those who believe and did not emigrate, okay, for you there is no guardianship of them until they emigrate. But if they seek help of you for the religion, then you must help, except against a people between yourself and whom a treaty. Okay, and Allah is seeing what you do. So now this is ayah, what we are told, the reward of hijra. And what is hijra? Like, you know, inna lazina amanu wa hajaru. What is hijra? Mahajir is from, what is to leave something, it when a person leaves something in order to save from its danger, in order to be protected from its harm. This is what hijra is. But Prophet, here there is a hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the muhajir is the one who gives up all that Allah has forbidden. You know, muhajir is he gives up all which Allah has forbidden, because sometimes it's easy to leave your house. People are waiting for that day when they can leave their house. That day when they came out, leaving the house, leaving the country, is not that difficult. What is more difficult is leaving what Allah has forbidden. He is muhajir because he sacrificed something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is mental hijra. You understand, one is physical hijra. Then there has to be mental hijra also, like an emotional shift from love of dunya to the love of akhirah, love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is one more hadith. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, worshipping during the period of widespread turmoil is like immigrating to me is like a hijra to me. And there is one more hadith, but Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if a person remains firm, ibadah of Allah during times of fitna, when everybody is leaving the haq one after the other, but a person stay firm, like, you know, I'm not going to stop, I'm not going to leave this, I'm going to continue this because my Allah loves it. So Allah is pleased with you. And Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and sun was rising, all were watching the sun rises, and said, on the day of judgment, Allah will bring up people whose light will be like the light of the sun. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, is it us, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, for you, khaira kaseera, meaning you has much good. These people, they are muhajireen, and you know, the fuqara, the poor ones, muhajir, those who do hijra, those who will be gathered from the corners of the earth. Ayah number 73, those who disbelieve are allies of one another. If you do not do so, meaning, O believers, if you do not help each other, if you do not struggle in this cause, if you don't remain firm in worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what will happen? There will be a fitna on the earth and great corruption. The fitna will spread. Then who knows, like, you know, who will know the Quran? Somebody has to sacrifice. Somebody has to put his effort. If you do not do, who is going to do it? Think about it. The forces of evil, how much they are spreading. So many evil is going on. We have to learn Quran and spread so that the evil goes off. وَالَّذِينَ آمُنُوا, and those who have belief. وَحَاجَرُوا, and they immigrated. وَجَاهَدُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, and fought in the cause of Allah. وَالَّذِينَ أَوْفُوا وَنَصَرُوا, and those who have given shelter and aided. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ حَقًّا, is there who are the believers truly. لَهُمْ مَغْفِرَةٌ وَرِزْقٌ كَرِيمٌ, for them is forgiving and noble provision. Jazakallah khair. Rest will complete in Juz 10, part 2, inshallah.